Although no description of Tanaman had yet been made public, the McCanns and their group of friends obviously knew of the description. So almost certainly, Robert Murat would have known. After all, for several days following Madeleine's disappearance, he spent most of the day in the police station translating for a series of witnesses and talking to the police. I raise the possibility, although I am not saying this is true, that Martin Smith may have secretly been informed of Jane Tanner's description of Tanaman, mainly because, as we've seen, the descriptions of Tanaman and Smithman are so strikingly similar. And again, I am not stating these as known facts, only hypothesizing based on what I know. I have asked Martin Smith in emails twice if he would be interviewed by me on camera to clear up these issues. On the first occasion he declined, and on the second, to date, he has not replied. In fact, I am not aware of any interviews the Smiths have given on camera. Earlier I suggested that the descriptions of both Sagresman and Tanaman could have been based on the same source, namely the oddly dressed Wojciech Krakowski. If in turn Smithman was based on Tanaman, then all three descriptions would turn out to be based on Wojciech Krakowski. Let's look at these descriptions. 1. The face. Sagresman, Caucasian with Latin colouring of medium complexion. Tanaman, dark-skinned individual, couldn't see his face. Smithman, difficult to see his face in the dark, didn't appear to have a beard or moustache. 2. The age. Sagresman, between 35 to 40 years of age. Tanaman, aged 35 to 40. Smithman, Martin Smith says 35 to 40. Peter Smith says about 35, maybe older, while Aoife Smith suggests 20 to 30. 3. Height. Sagresman, around 170 to 175 centimetres in height, 5'7 to 5'9. Tanaman, about 1.7 metres tall, 5'7. Smithman, Martin and Peter Smith say he was about 1.75 metres to 1.8 metres tall, 5'9 to 5'11. Aoife Smith says 1.7 to 1.75, 5'7 to 5'9. 4. The hair. Sagresman, curly dark brown hair that ran down to the back of his neck and in a ponytail. Tanaman, very dark, thick hair, longer at the back. Smithman, all the Smiths say his hair was brown and shortish. Aoife says his hair colour was light brown, thick and long on top. 5. The jacket. Sagresman, he wore a cream-coloured cloth coat stroke jacket of the same material as his trousers. Tanaman, wearing a dark duffy-type jacket, but not that thick, a sort of anorak of the same material as his trousers. Smithman, the man was wearing a dark jacket. Martin Smith couldn't remember what top the man was wearing when first questioned, but later remembered that he wore a darkish top. 6. The trousers. Sagresman, he wore cloth trousers of the same material as his jacket. Tanaman, he was wearing linen-type chino-style cloth trousers, beige to golden in colour, like quartzite, of the same material as his jacket. Smithman, the man was wearing light-coloured trousers. Aoife Smith says, beige in colour, cotton fabric, thicker than linen. Martin Smith says, he was wearing cream or beige-coloured cloth trousers in a classic cut. 7. The shoes. Sagresman, his shoes, he thinks, were dark brown and of the type that needed to be shined or polished, i.e. leather. In his book, Dr. Gonçalo Amaral says they were shoes of a classic type. Tanaman, his shoes were dark in colour, classic type. Smithman, no comments made. 8. The build. Sagresman, no comment made. Tanaman, slim physical appearance. Smithman, the Smiths all say average build, except that Martin Smith says he had an average build, a bit on the thin side. 9. Not a tourist. Sagresman, no comment made, but Gonçalo Amaral writes in his book, Chapter 3, the stranger did not look like a tourist. Tanaman, by the way he was dressed, he gave her the impression that he was not a tourist, because he was very warmly dressed. Smithman, the man didn't look like a tourist. The Portuguese police report Martin Smith's evidence on this point as follows. Urged, he states that the individual did not appear to be a tourist. He cannot explain this further. It was simply his perception given the individual's clothing. The three descriptions are not exactly the same, but the similarities are obvious. Let's look further at mainstream media reports about the Smith man sighting. In The Sun, 3rd of January 2008, Mary Smith is asked about the claimed sighting and says, "We didn't think anything of it." But in another paper, The Daily Mail, on the same day, Martin Smith is quoted as saying that his wife, without warning, approached the man with the question, "Oh, is she asleep?" He is said to have ignored her. Mary Smith declined to make a statement to the police confirming her evidence. Moreover, neither Martin Smith nor his two children, who did make police witness statements, referred to this alleged encounter in their statements. So, did Mary Smith not think anything of it? Or did she approach the man and ask him a question? In the same Daily Mail article, far from not thinking anything of it, Martin Smith is quoted as saying, "It was a disturbing encounter." Later in the same report, we get more details. An Irish holidaymaker has spoken publicly for the first time of his disturbing encounter with a man carrying a child wrapped in a blanket on the night Madeleine McCann disappeared. The sighting is strikingly similar to one by a friend of the McCanns, Jane Tanner. In hindsight, the retired Mr. Smith said the man's rude behaviour should have aroused his suspicions. Martin Smith said, "The one thing we noted afterwards was that he gave us no greeting. My wife Mary remembered afterwards that she asked him, 'Oh, is she asleep?' But he never acknowledged her one way or another. He just put his head down and averted his eyes. This is very unusual in a tourist town at such a quiet time of the year." So Martin Smith described this as a disturbing encounter with a man who behaved rudely and was very unusual. The Mail article continued, "Mr. Smith said it was some time before the family realised they could be star witnesses. We were out the night it happened. We went home about 9:50 p.m. and we heard nothing at all about Madeleine McCann until the next day. I was taking my son Peter to the airport, and on my way back I heard that a kidnapping happened in the village of Luz. We were looking at all the commotion on Sky News, and we really felt quite helpless. We had two grandchildren with us at the time, aged 4 and 5, and it had a terrible effect on them. They all wanted to sleep in the same room as us until we went home on the Wednesday." We see contradiction here with Mary Smith's "we didn't think anything of it" and her husband's "he was rude, it was very unusual, disturbing." One odd feature of this Daily Mail report was that the child was wrapped in a blanket. One wonders where that came from, as none of the three Smiths who made statements mentioned a blanket. They all insisted she was dressed only in pyjamas. Here is what three of the Smiths said in their official witness statements. Aoife Smith said that she didn't see the child's face because she was lying vertically against the man's left shoulder. Peter Smith said the girl was asleep, her eyelids were closed. Martin Smith says the man didn't speak, nor did the child, as she was in a deep sleep. Martin Smith said he put his head down. His son Peter, he did not try to hide his face, nor did he lower his gaze. Another issue is how Martin Smith's memory seemed to improve between making his first statement on the 26th of May 2007 and a second one in January 2008. In May 2007, the police asked him to describe what the man was wearing. In a statement he signed, he wrote, "He did not notice the body clothing and cannot describe the colour or fashion of the same." By January, 8 months later, he was able to say the man was wearing beige trousers and darkish top, maybe a jacket or blazer. To our knowledge, neither Martin Smith nor his two children in May 2007 could remember what the man was wearing above his waist. Peter Smith said that he also does not remember the clothing the individual wore or his shoes. His younger sister, Aoife Smith, said that she did not see what he was wearing above his trousers, as the child covered him almost completely at the top. So it is interesting that Martin Smith claimed over 8 months later that the man was wearing a darkish top, maybe a jacket or blazer. I'm now going to look at the extraordinary claim made by Martin Smith over 4 months after he first reported his sighting. On the 20th of September, he phoned Leicestershire Police. This time he made the claim that the man he had seen over 4 months ago may have been Jerry McCann. Let's see how this development came about. Why did he think this? because, he said, he had seen Jerry McCann on his return to England on the 9th of September on a TV news bulletin, walking down the steps of his plane carrying his son Sean on his left shoulder. And how did that enable him to say it was Jerry McCann that he saw back on the 3rd of May? Gonçalo Amaral supplies an answer in his book. It was, quote, that way of carrying his child, that way of walking. So it was the way Jerry McCann was carrying his son Sean down the steps of the plane that made his mind go back and think it probably was Jerry McCann that he saw. Remember, he saw the man for a second or two in the dark over 4 months ago. When carrying a child who is asleep or very tired, a natural way to carry your child, if you have no buggy or pushchair, is on one shoulder. The twins were just 2.5 years old. It's normal for passengers with an infant that age to carry their child down steep aircraft steps on their shoulder. And it appears that Martin Smith didn't inform the police immediately he saw the news broadcast. The evidence suggests that he waited several days before doing so, 11 days in fact, as Leicestershire police records seem to show that Smith made the call on the 20th of September. He added that he was 60 to 80% sure it was Jerry McCann, based, it seems, on the way he was carrying his infant son on his shoulder. Gonçalo Amaral was told the news. He made provisional arrangements to interview Martin Smith again. But on the 2nd of October, he was taken off the investigation by the Chief of Police and replaced by Paolo Rabello. And there the matter rested, until the McCann team began contacting Martin Smith and his family, probably around December 2007. And as I will show in a moment, very soon, the McCann team began placing significance on the Smith man's sighting. Given that Martin Smith had been 60 to 80% sure in September that he had really seen Jerry McCann that night in May, that seems like a remarkable turnaround. I should also mention here another statement to be found in the police files, of a sighting by a couple in the early hours of the 5th of May, just over 24 hours after Madeleine was reported missing. This alleged sighting was in Alvor, about 10 miles east of Praia da Luz. They say they saw a white van which pulled up in the middle of the road. A man got out carrying a child and staggered up a bank in a drunken manner. Soon after, they saw a woman who appeared worried. One of the witnesses, Richard McCluskey, after giving his initial statement to the police on the 9th of May, contacted the police again 4 months later in September to give a second statement, in which he said, "I have watched a good deal of news coverage about the McCanns over the past week or so. Another thing which has played on my mind is the coverage of Mr. McCann walking off the aeroplane holding one of his young children. The way he was holding the child over his left shoulder reminded me of the man carrying the child from the white van in Portugal." There is a great deal of coincidence with regards this sighting and the Smith sighting. Both Richard McCluskey and Martin Smith gave statements of a man carrying a child. McCluskey's statement was taken 4 days after his sighting. Smith's was reported 13 days after his sighting. They both gave a voluntary second statement in mid-September which implicated Jerry McCann, and they both made these new statements because of the way Jerry McCann was carrying his child on his left shoulder off the plane. We are surely entitled to ask, was someone feeding them a script? I will mention here that I am aware that a significant number of people believe that Smith man was indeed Jerry McCann. And you are perhaps wondering why I am not making more of this possibility. Well, I don't rule that out. But bear in mind, the Smith sighting is extremely similar to the very suspect Tanner sighting. I have also seen evidence which suggests to me that Madeleine may have died on or around the 29th of April. If this is true, it is unlikely that Jerry McCann, 4 days later, would walk down a public street with his daughter's corpse for everyone to see. I hope to highlight this evidence in another film. Before I move on, I just want to deal with one report that surfaced in the Daily Mirror on the 16th of October 2013. Just 2 days after the BBC Crime Watch McCann special, which I'm going to examine later on, it claimed that Martin Smith had tried to talk to the Portuguese police early on, but that they were not interested in his sighting. The report included several quotes from Martin Smith. Here are some extracts from the Mirror's report. A key witness in the Madeleine McCann case claimed yesterday that Portuguese police failed to take his evidence seriously. Mr. Smith, a former Unilever executive, made a statement along with his wife Mary, daughter Aoife and son Peter soon after Madeleine vanished on the 3rd of May 2007. Retired businessman Martin Smith, 64, provided details for an e-fit of the prime suspect after spotting the mystery man carrying a child at 10 p.m. close to where the three-year-old vanished more than 6 years ago. But he said his information was virtually ignored by local officers because they were too busy chasing up another sighting of a man near Kate and Jerry McCann's holiday apartment in Praia da Luz 45 minutes earlier. Scotland Yard detectives reinvestigating the case after 6 years have now established that the suspect Portuguese police were so keen to trace, spotted by holidaymaker Jane Tanner at 9:20 p.m, was just an innocent British tourist returning with his own child from a creche. This article is misleading by suggesting that the Portuguese police took details from the Smiths for an e-fit, yet went on to ignore this. It was also misleading in suggesting that the police were too busy chasing up the sighting of another man, namely Tannerman. In fact, the Portuguese police were suspicious of Tanner's claimed sighting from day one, which is why they waited over 3 weeks before even publicising it to the public. And even then, they did so only after the Chancellor of the Exchequer, Gordon Brown, leaned heavily on the Portuguese authorities to do so. Besides that, we know from Dr. Amaral's book that as soon as the Smiths did get around to mentioning their sighting, the Portuguese police reacted swiftly and invited them over to take their statements. The Mirror report is in many respects false. Like many other mainstream media reports in this case, this false claim was probably, like so many other Madeleine McCann stories, supplied by the McCann's public relations spokesman, Clarence Mitchell. I want to go back just for a moment to look at a very curious development in the case just after Robert Murat was made a suspect. He was made a suspect on Tuesday the 15th of May. Within 24 hours of Murat being named as the chief suspect, three separate members of the McCann's group of friends, the Tapas Seven, Rachel Oldfield, Russell O'Brien and Fiona Payne, all made separate statements to the Portuguese police claiming they had seen Robert Murat in the vicinity of the Ocean Club around the time Madeleine disappeared. They even stuck to their story when all three of them were summoned to a tense head-to-head confrontation with Murat in a pokey room in Portimao police station on the 11th of July that year. Taken together with a fourth Tapas 7 member, Jane Tanner, having also claimed to be sure that it was Robert Murat she'd seen carrying a child away from the McCann's apartment on the 3rd of May. Was this an organised effort by the McCann team to fit up Murat as the abductor of Madeleine McCann? Was he perhaps the fall guy? The patsy? These are issues I hope to cover in depth in a forthcoming look at the role of Robert Murat in this case. I'm going to conclude my analysis of Smithman with a look at how the McCann team came to bring great significance to the Irish family sighting, as we'll see from quite early on. And then I'll finish off with an in-depth look at how the BBC Crime Watch team back in October 2013 suddenly rescued this sighting from complete obscurity and helped DCI Andy Redwood to make Smithman Scotland Yard's number one suspect. It is an extraordinary story. So far, the Smithman sighting has gone through what I might call three phases. Phase 1, from the 3rd to the 15th of May 2007, an unreported sighting. The Smiths claimed to have seen a man carrying a child, but did not report it. Phase 2, from the 16th of May to the 20th of September 2007, a reported sighting. The Smiths report what they say they saw, and the Portuguese police interview three members of the Smith family. Phase 3, from the 20th of September to December 2007. Could it be Jerry McCann? Martin Smith triggers new interest in the sighting by claiming that he was 60 to 80% sure he really saw Jerry McCann that night in early May. I'm now going to look at what I'm calling Phase 4. January 2008 to November 2008. The McCanns take over the Smith sighting. To see how Phase 4 developed and how the McCanns and their team got involved, we need to go back and look at the press coverage in the first week of January 2008. The news of the McCann team's involvement with the Smithman sighting was first broken by Rupert Murdoch's son and the Daily Mail and Mirror on the 3rd of January 2008. The Sun report told us, private detectives hunting the Madeleine McCann case are to quiz an Irish family who may have been the last to see her alive. Martin Smith, his wife and children told cops they saw a man carrying a little blonde girl in Pride of Luz on the night Maddie vanished. Investigators from the Metodo 3 agency, hired by Maddie's parents, Jerry and Kate, are preparing to travel to Ireland to interview them. Mr. Smith, who has already spoken to Portuguese cops over the sighting, said yesterday, "I'd talk to anyone to move this investigation on. I think about Maddie every day," he added. "I found the Portuguese cops not to be the most efficient bunch." The Mirror report added this detail. The McCann spokesman said yesterday, "Our detectives are being very methodical, and I am quite sure that this family will be on their list." We learned from that article that the investigators were from Metodo 3. In my earlier film, Buried by Mainstream Media, I showed what a disreputable agency Metodo 3 were. I also explained that the entire McCann private investigation team was run by Cheshire businessman Brian Kennedy. Mark Hollingsworth, who writes for the Evening Standard, wrote about the McCann's private investigations and is alleged to have said that key witnesses were questioned far too aggressively by Kennedy's investigators, so much so that some of them later refused to talk to police. The claim in the Mirror report that the Metodo 3 men were being very methodical was laughable. This was the outfit whose boss, Francisco Marco, had lied by boasting that Madeleine was alive and that his men knew where she was and were closing in on the kidnappers, and finally promised that Maddie would be home by Christmas. By the end of the month, Brian Kennedy had indeed made contact with the Smiths because of a letter sent on the 30th of January by Detective Sergeant Liam Hogan of the Garda Detective Branch in Drogheda to the Portuguese police. Hogan wrote, "He has been contacted by numerous tabloid press looking for stories. He has been contacted by Mr. Brian Kennedy, who was supporting the McCann family, to take part in a photo fit exercise." He added, "I do not believe that Martin Smith is courting the press. In my view, he is a genuine person. He is known locally and is a very decent person." What happened next in this story is shrouded in mystery. Martin Smith, to our knowledge, has said nothing publicly about it. The McCann team have said almost nothing. Most of what we know comes from a former top MI5 man. What we can distill from what little we know is the following. In April 2008, a company called Oakley International, headed by fraudster Kevin Halligan, took over most of the McCann team investigation from Metodo 3. After working for the McCanns for barely 4 months and pocketing nearly £600,000 for his work for the team, Halligan went on the run from the police until October 2009, when he was finally run to ground in a £700-a-night Oxfordshire hotel and taken to Belmarsh top security prison to await extradition to the US on a $2 million fraud charge. He was found guilty and served over 4 years in prison. Halligan employed as his right-hand man a man from Bury, Lancashire, called Henry Exton. Exton was the former head of MI5's covert intelligence unit, but fell from grace when he got a criminal record for stealing a bottle of perfume from Manchester Airport. The Sunday Times recently told us that Henry Exton, sometime during 2008, maybe together with others, visited the Smiths. We don't know where or when this mysterious meeting took place, but doing the best we can place the visit at some time between April and October 2008, most probably in the spring. What we also know on the record from him and the McCanns is that during this period he produced two e-fits. These were the ones shown on BBC Crime Watch in October 2013 and were then described as the central focus of the Scotland Yard investigation. Henry Exton, the McCanns, and now Scotland Yard are all united behind the claim that the Smith family produced these two e-fits. I am sceptical of this, and in a moment I will explain why. But first, let's move to what I am calling Phase 5 of the Smith sighting. January to May 2009, Smithman features in a Paul McCann documentary. Shortly after Kevin Halligan and his team were sacked in disgrace by the McCann team, Brian Kennedy appointed local man and former detective inspector Dave Edgar to lead the investigation. This was around November 2008. Some weeks later, another retired police officer, former Detective Sergeant Arthur Cowley, who lived in a cottage high up on Halkin Mount in Wales, was appointed to join him. Ostensibly, these two men were appointed to look for Madeleine. But in reality, it seems that they spent much of their time preparing for a very significant documentary on the Madeleine McCann case, produced by Mentone Media in association with Channel 4. It was this documentary that the McCanns used to promote their suggestion that Jane Tanner's Tanner Man and the Smith family's Smith Man might be the very same person. How likely was it that a man seen with an abducted child by Jane Tanner at 9:15 p.m. could be seen 45 minutes later, less than half a mile away, still carrying the abducted child? Not only were Tanner Man and Smith Man linked in the documentary, there were two separate discussions in the film about this possibility. During the documentary, three other sightings of suspicious-looking men were also discussed, as well as Tanner Man and Smith Man.
The most likely sighting of Madeleine and her abductor was by Jane Tanner, a friend of the McCanns. In the files, Kate believes another witness statement from an Irish family describes a very similar sighting to Jane's, less than a mile from the McCanns' apartment.
The reason why this is significant is both sightings were given independently. So when this family gave their statement, they weren't aware of Jane's description, and there's actually quite a lot of similarities. And it does beg the question, I mean, how many people carry the children on a cold night, not covered, you know, nothing on their arms or the feet, no blanket. Now, either there's been two people carrying children in that way who haven't come forward to eliminate themselves, or potentially they're related.
But you think that child is Madeleine?
I think there's a good chance it could be Madeleine. Certainly the description there sounds to me like Madeleine.
Kate and the Find Madeleine campaign coordinator travel to the search team's offices. They want to discuss the details of the upcoming reconstructions and three potentially key witness statements that all tell of a man hanging round the McCann's apartment in the days leading up to May the 3rd, 2007.
Apart from the obvious of Jane, is sighting number three, the man in the alouette at the back of the apartment.
Number three is
definitely a very important sighting because it links them.
The investigators have examined the statements from the three different witnesses and are now convinced that prior to Madeleine's abduction, the McCanns were being watched. The team hope this new information will give them the breakthrough they need.
You'd think it's got to be the same person, wouldn't you, really?
Yeah. And all three say that he was watching the apartment.
Yeah. We're here to discuss the pending reconstruction that we want done.
So, basically, it looks like we've got five sightings, really. Two, a man with a child, and three, just a suspicious individual.
Yeah.
At the beginning of this discussion, Kate McCann introduces a very important idea. She says both sightings were given independently. But what did Gonçalo Amaral say in his book? The Smiths learn that, according to Jane Tanner's statements, Murat is definitely the man encountered on the night of the abduction. Mr. Smith then gets in touch with the Irish police to relate what he saw on the night of May the 3rd. Were they working from the same script? Let's now look at the second time Smithman comes up in this documentary.
It is possible that Jane Tanner is not the only person who saw Madeleine being carried away by the abductor. Forty minutes after Jane's sighting, and half a mile away from the McCann's apartment, a family also saw a man carrying a young girl away from the town. Later, The witness thought that this might have been Jerry McCann, but this was investigated and ruled out by the Portuguese police.
A man was seen here carrying a child just before 10 p.m. on the night Madeleine was abducted. When the man saw the family, he appeared furtive and veered off to one side and carried on walking. But obviously, anyone carrying a child at night, it's really important. We need to find out who this person was.
I was with my family. We'd been out for the night and we were walking up this street when I saw a man and he was carrying a child. I thought they were father and daughter, so I wasn't so suspicious. The girl was about 4. She looked like my granddaughter, blonde hair, pale white skin, typically British. The man didn't look like a tourist. I can't explain why. It was probably from his clothes.
Someone knows the information, and someone knows who took Madeleine, and someone knows where she is. Let's get moving. Let's get the phone ringing.
The first thing to note about this statement is Dave Edgar's spin on what the Smith family say about their sightings. He says the man appeared furtive and veered off to one side. To our knowledge, the Smiths in their statements do not say he appeared furtive, nor veered off to one side. He appears to have misled the viewers. Secondly, the family witness statement that is read out by the narrator is not a direct reading from Martin Smith's statement. It is selective and edited. Third, despite Martin Smith's statement back in September 2007 to claim that Jerry McCann was probably the man he'd seen on that dark night in May, this is now curtly dismissed by the narrator, who says the witness thought that this might have been Jerry McCann, but this was investigated and ruled out by the Portuguese police. The effigies said to have been created by the Smiths during 2008 were not shown in this documentary. Why not? If the McCann team believed that these effigies were drawn up by the Smiths, as they had apparently been told by ex-MI5 investigator Henry Exton, why were they not shown to all the viewers back in May 2009? He was wearing linen-type chino-style cloth trousers, beige to golden in colour, like quartzite, of the same material as his jacket. Smithman, the man was wearing light-coloured trousers. Aoife Smith says, beige in colour, cotton fabric, thicker than linen. Martin Smith says he was wearing cream or beige coloured cloth trousers in a classic cut. 7. The shoes, Sagres man. His shoes, he thinks, were dark brown and of the type that needed to be shined or polished, i.e. leather. In his book, Dr. Gonçalo Amaral says they were shoes of a classic type. Tannerman, his shoes were dark in colour, classic type. Smithman, no comments made. 8. The build, Sagres man, no comment made. Tannerman, slim physical appearance. Smithman, the Smiths all say average build, except that Martin Smith says he had an average build, a bit on the thin side. 9. Not a tourist. Sagres man, no comment made, but Gonçalo Amaral writes in his book chapter 3, the stranger did not look like a tourist. Tannerman, by the way he was dressed, he gave her the impression that he was not a tourist, because he was very warmly dressed. Smithman, the man didn't look like a tourist. The Portuguese police report Martin Smith's evidence on this point as follows. Urged, he states that the individual did not appear to be a tourist. He cannot explain this further. It was simply his perception given the individual's clothing. The three descriptions are not exactly the same, but the similarities are obvious. Let's look further at mainstream media reports about the Smithman sighting. In The Sun, 3rd of January 2008, Mary Smith is asked about the claimed sighting and says, "We didn't think anything of it." But in another paper, the Daily Mail, on the same day, Martin Smith is quoted as saying that his wife, without warning, approached the man with the question, "Oh, is she asleep?" He is said to have ignored her. Mary Smith declined to make a statement to the police confirming her evidence. Moreover, neither Martin Smith nor his two children, who did make police witness statements, referred to this alleged encounter in their statements. So, did Mary Smith not think anything of it? Or did she approach the man and ask him a question? In the same Daily Mail article, far from not thinking anything of it, Martin Smith is quoted as saying, "It was a disturbing encounter." Later in the same report, we get more details. An Irish holidaymaker has spoken publicly for the first time of his disturbing encounter with a man carrying a child wrapped in a blanket on the night Madeleine McCann disappeared. The sighting is strikingly similar to one by a friend of the McCanns, Jane Tanner. In hindsight, the retired Mr. Smith said the man's rude behaviour should have aroused his suspicions. Martin Smith said, "The one thing we noted afterwards was that he gave us no greeting. My wife Mary remembered afterwards that she asked him, 'Oh, is she asleep?' But he never acknowledged her one way or another. He just put his head down and averted his eyes. This is very unusual in a tourist town at such a quiet time of the year." So Martin Smith described this as a disturbing encounter with a man who behaved rudely and was very unusual. The Mail article continued, "Mr. Smith said it was some time before the family realised they could be star witnesses. We were out the night it happened. We went home about 9:50 p.m. and we heard nothing at all about Madeleine McCann until the next day. I was taking my son Peter to the airport and on my way back I heard that a kidnapping happened in the village of Luz. We were looking at all the commotion on Sky News and we really felt quite helpless. We had two grandchildren with us at the time, aged 4 and 5, and it had a terrible effect on them. They all wanted to sleep in the same room as us until we went home on the Wednesday." We see contradiction here with Mary Smith's "we didn't think anything of it" and her husband's "he was rude, it was very unusual, disturbing." One odd feature of this Daily Mail report was that the child was wrapped in a blanket. One wonders where that came from, as none of the three Smiths who made statements mentioned a blanket. They all insisted she was dressed only in pyjamas. Here is what three of the Smiths said in their official witness statements. Aoife Smith said that she didn't see the child's face because she was lying vertically against the man's left shoulder. Peter Smith said the girl was asleep, her eyelids were closed. Martin Smith says the man didn't speak, nor did the child, as she was in a deep sleep. Martin Smith said he put his head down. His son Peter, he did not try to hide his face, nor did he lower his gaze. Another issue is how Martin Smith's memory seemed to improve between making his first statement on the 26th of May 2007 and a second one in January 2008. In May 2007, the police asked him to describe what the man was wearing. In a statement he signed, he wrote, "He did not notice the body clothing and cannot describe the colour or fashion of the same." By January, 8 months later, he was able to say the man was wearing beige trousers and darkish top, maybe a jacket or blazer. To our knowledge, neither Martin Smith nor his two children in May 2007 could remember what the man was wearing above his waist. Peter Smith said that he also does not remember the clothing the individual wore or his shoes. His younger sister, Aoife Smith, said that she did not see what he was wearing above his trousers, as the child covered him almost completely at the top. So it is interesting that Martin Smith claimed over 8 months later that the man was wearing a darkish top, maybe a jacket or blazer. I'm now going to look at the extraordinary claim made by Martin Smith over 4 months after he first reported his sighting. On the 20th of September, he phoned Leicestershire Police. This time he made the claim that the man he had seen over 4 months ago may have been Jerry McCann. Let's see how this development came about. Why did he think this? Because, he said, he had seen Jerry McCann on his return to England on the 9th of September on a TV news bulletin, walking down the steps of his plane carrying his son Sean on his left shoulder. And how did that enable him to say it was Jerry McCann that he saw back on the 3rd of May? Gonçalo Amaral supplies an answer in his book. It was, quote, that way of carrying his child, that way of walking. So it was the way Jerry McCann was carrying his son Sean down the steps of the plane that made his mind go back and think it probably was Jerry McCann that he saw. Remember, he saw the man for a second or two in the dark over 4 months ago. When carrying a child who is asleep or very tired, a natural way to carry your child, if you have no buggy or pushchair, is on one's shoulder. The twins were just 2.5 years old. It's normal for passengers with an infant that age to carry their child down steep aircraft steps on their shoulder. And it appears that Martin Smith didn't inform the police immediately he saw the news broadcast. The evidence suggests that he waited several days before doing so, 11 days in fact, as Leicestershire police records seem to show that Smith made the call on the 20th of September. He added that he was 60 to 80% sure it was Jerry McCann, based, it seems, on the way he was carrying his infant son on his shoulder. Gonçalo Amaral was told the news. He made provisional arrangements to interview Martin Smith again. But on the 2nd of October, he was taken off the investigation by the Chief of Police and replaced by Paolo Rabello. And there the matter rested, until the McCann team began contacting Martin Smith and his family, probably around December 2007. And as I will show in a moment, very soon, the McCann team began placing significance on the Smith man's sighting. Given that Martin Smith had been 60 to 80% sure in September that he had really seen Jerry McCann that night in May, that seems like a remarkable turnaround. I should also mention here another statement to be found in the police files of a sighting by a couple in the early hours of the 5th of May, just over 24 hours after Madeleine was reported missing. This alleged sighting was in Alvor, about 10 miles east of Praia da Luz. They say they saw a white van which pulled up in the middle of the road. A man got out carrying a child and staggered up a bank in a drunken manner. Soon after, they saw a woman who appeared worried. One of the witnesses, Richard McCluskey, after giving his initial statement to the police on the 9th of May, contacted the police again 4 months later in September to give a second statement, in which he said, "I have watched a good deal of news coverage about the McCanns over the past week or so. Another thing which has played on my mind is the coverage of Mr. McCann walking off the aeroplane holding one of his young children. The way he was holding the child over his left shoulder reminded me of the man carrying the child from the white van in Portugal." There is a great deal of coincidence with regards this sighting and the Smith sighting. Both Richard McCluskey and Martin Smith gave statements of a man carrying a child. McCluskey's statement was taken 4 days after his sighting. Smith's was reported 13 days after his sighting. They both gave a voluntary second statement in mid-September which implicated Jerry McCann, and they both made these new statements because of the way Jerry McCann was carrying his child on his left shoulder off the plane. We are surely entitled to ask, was someone feeding them a script? I will mention here that I am aware that a significant number of people believe that Smith man was indeed Jerry McCann, and you are perhaps wondering why I am not making more of this possibility. Well, I don't rule that out. But bear in mind, the Smith sighting is extremely similar to the very suspect Tanner sighting. I have also seen evidence which suggests to me that Madeleine may have died on or around the 29th of April. If this is true, it is unlikely that Jerry McCann, 4 days later, would walk down a public street with his daughter's corpse for everyone to see. I hope to highlight this evidence in another film. Before I move on, I just want to deal with one report that surfaced in the Daily Mirror on the 16th of October 2013. Just 2 days after the BBC Crime Watch McCann special, which I'm going to examine later on, it claimed that Martin Smith had tried to talk to the Portuguese police early on, but that they were not interested in his sighting. The report included several quotes from Martin Smith. Here are some extracts from the Mirror's report. A key witness in the Madeleine McCann case claimed yesterday that Portuguese police failed to take his evidence seriously. Mr. Smith, a former Unilever executive, made a statement along with his wife Mary, daughter Aoife and son Peter soon after Madeleine vanished on the 3rd of May 2007. Retired businessman Martin Smith, 64, provided details for an e-fit of the prime suspect after spotting the mystery man carrying a child at 10 p.m. close to where the three-year-old vanished more than 6 years ago. But he said his information was virtually ignored by local officers because they were too busy chasing up another sighting of a man near Kate and Jerry McCann's holiday apartment in Praia da Luz 45 minutes earlier. Scotland Yard detectives reinvestigating the case after 6 years have now established that the suspect Portuguese police were so keen to trace, spotted by holidaymaker Jane Tanner at 9:20 p.m, was just an innocent British tourist returning with his own child from a creche. This article is misleading by suggesting that the Portuguese police took details from the Smiths for an e-fit, yet went on to ignore this. It was also misleading in suggesting that the police were too busy chasing up the sighting of another man, namely Tannerman. In fact, the Portuguese police were suspicious of Tanner's claimed sighting from day one, which is why they waited over 3 weeks before even publicising it to the public. And even then, they did so only after the Chancellor of the Exchequer, Gordon Brown, leaned heavily on the Portuguese authorities to do so. Besides that, we know from Dr. Amaral's book that as soon as the Smiths did get around to mentioning their sighting, the Portuguese police reacted swiftly and invited them over to take their statements. The Mirror report is in many respects false. Like many other mainstream media reports in this case, this false claim was probably, like so many other Madeleine McCann stories, supplied by the McCann's public relations spokesman, Clarence Mitchell. I want to go back just for a moment to look at a very curious development in the case just after Robert Murat was made a suspect. He was made a suspect on Tuesday the 15th of May. Within 24 hours of Murat being named as the chief suspect, three separate members of the McCann's group of friends, the Tapas Seven, Rachel Oldfield, Russell O'Brien and Fiona Payne, all made separate statements to the Portuguese police claiming they had seen Robert Murat in the vicinity of the Ocean Club around the time Madeleine disappeared. They even stuck to their story when all three of them were summoned to a tense head-to-head confrontation with Murat in a pokey room in Portimao police station on the 11th of July that year. Taken together with a fourth Tapas 7 member, Jane Tanner, having also claimed to be sure that it was Robert Murat she'd seen carrying a child away from the McCann's apartment on the 3rd of May. Was this an organised effort by the McCann team to fit up Murat as the abductor of Madeleine McCann? Was he perhaps the fall guy, the patsy? These are issues I hope to cover in depth in a forthcoming look at the role of Robert Murat in this case. I'm going to conclude my analysis of Smithman with a look at how the McCann team came to bring great significance to the Irish family's sighting, as we'll see from quite early on. And then I'll finish off with an in-depth look at how the BBC Crime Watch team back in October 2013 suddenly rescued this sighting from complete obscurity and helped DCI Andy Redwood to make Smithman Scotland Yard's number one suspect. It is an extraordinary story. So far, the Smithman sighting has gone through what I might call three phases. Phase 1, from the 3rd to the 15th of May 2007, an unreported sighting. The Smiths claimed to have seen a man carrying a child, but did not report it. Phase 2, from the 16th of May to the 20th of September 2007, a reported sighting. The Smiths report what they say they saw, and the Portuguese police interview three members of the Smith family. Phase 3, from the 20th of September to December 2007. Could it be Jerry McCann? Martin Smith triggers new interest in the sighting by claiming that he was 60 to 80% sure he really saw Jerry McCann that night in early May. I'm now going to look at what I'm calling Phase 4. January 2008 to November 2008. The McCanns take over the Smith sighting. To see how Phase 4 developed and how the McCanns and their team got involved, we need to go back and look at the press coverage in the first week of January 2008. The news of the McCann team's involvement with the Smithman sighting was first broken by Rupert Murdoch's son and the Daily Mail and Mirror on the 3rd of January 2008. The Sun report told us, private detectives hunting the Madeleine McCann case are to quiz an Irish family who may have been the last to see her alive. Martin Smith, his wife and children told cops they saw a man carrying a little blonde girl in Praia de Luz on the night Maddie vanished. Investigators from the Metodo 3 agency, hired by Maddie's parents, Jerry and Kate, are preparing to travel to Ireland to interview them. Mr. Smith, who has already spoken to Portuguese cops over the sighting, said yesterday, "I'd talk to anyone to move this investigation on. I think about Maddie every day," he added. "I found the Portuguese cops not to be the most efficient bunch." The Mirror report added this detail. The McCann spokesman said yesterday, "Our detectives are being very methodical, and I am quite sure that this family will be on their list." We learned from that article that the investigators were from Metodo 3. In my earlier film, Buried by Mainstream Media, I showed what a disreputable agency Metodo 3 were. I also explained that the entire McCann private investigation team was run by Cheshire businessman Brian Kennedy. Mark Hollingsworth, who writes for the Evening Standard, wrote about the McCann's private investigations and is alleged to have said that key witnesses were questioned far too aggressively by Kennedy's investigators, so much so that some of them later refused to talk to police. The claim in the Mirror report that the Metodo 3 men were being very methodical was laughable. This was the outfit whose boss, Francisco Marco, had lied by boasting that Madeleine was alive and that his men knew where she was and were closing in on the kidnappers, and finally promised that Maddie would be home by Christmas. By the end of the month, Brian Kennedy had indeed made contact with the Smiths because of a letter sent on the 30th of January by Detective Sergeant Liam Hogan of the Garda Detective Branch in Drogheda to the Portuguese police. Hogan wrote, "He has been contacted by numerous tabloid press looking for stories. He has been contacted by Mr. Brian Kennedy, who was supporting the McCann family, to take part in a photo fit exercise." He added, "I do not believe that Martin Smith is courting the press. In my view, he is a genuine person. He is known locally and is a very decent person." What happened next in this story is shrouded in mystery. Martin Smith, to our knowledge, has said nothing publicly about it. The McCann team have said almost nothing. Most of what we know comes from a former top MI5 man. What we can distill from what little we know is the following. In April 2008, a company called Oakley International, headed by fraudster Kevin Halligan, took over most of the McCann team investigation from Metodo 3. After working for the McCanns for barely 4 months and pocketing nearly £600,000 for his work for the team, Halligan went on the run from the police until October 2009, when he was finally run to ground in a £700-a-night Oxfordshire hotel and taken to Belmarsh Top Security Prison to await extradition to the US on a $2 million fraud charge. He was found guilty and served over 4 years in prison. Halligan employed as his right-hand man a man from Bury, Lancashire, called Henry Exton. Exton was the former head of MI5's covert intelligence unit, but fell from grace when he got a criminal record for stealing a bottle of perfume from Manchester Airport. The Sunday Times recently told us that Henry Exton, sometime during 2008, maybe together with others, visited the Smiths. We don't know where or when this mysterious meeting took place, but doing the best we can place the visit at some time between April and October 2008, most probably in the spring. What we also know on the record from him and the McCanns is that during this period he produced two e-fits. These were the ones shown on BBC Crime Watch in October 2013 and were then described as the central focus of the Scotland Yard investigation. Henry Exton, the McCanns, and now Scotland Yard are all united behind the claim that the Smith family produced these two e-fits. I am sceptical of this, and in a moment I will explain why. But first, let's move to what I am calling Phase 5 of the Smith sighting. January to May 2009, Smithman features in a pro-McCann documentary. Shortly after Kevin Halligan and his team were sacked in disgrace by the McCann team, Brian Kennedy appointed local man and former detective inspector Dave Edgar to lead the investigation. This was around November 2008. Some weeks later, another retired police officer, former Detective Sergeant Arthur Cowley, who lived in a cottage high up on Halkin Mount in Wales, was appointed to join him. Ostensibly, these two men were appointed to look for Madeleine. But in reality, it seems that they spent much of their time preparing for a very significant documentary on the Madeleine McCann case, produced by Mentone Media in association with Channel 4. It was this documentary that the McCanns used to promote their suggestion that Jane Tanner's Tanner Man and the Smith family's Smith Man might be the very same person. How likely was it that a man seen with an abducted child by Jane Tanner at 9:15 p.m. could be seen 45 minutes later, less than half a mile away, still carrying the abducted child? Not only were Tanner Man and Smith Man linked in the documentary, there were two separate discussions in the film about this possibility. During the documentary, three other sightings of suspicious-looking men were also discussed, as well as Tanner Man and Smith Man.
The most likely sighting of Madeleine and her abductor was by Jane Tanner, a friend of the McCanns. In the files, Kate believes another witness statement from an Irish family describes a very similar sighting to Jane's, less than a mile from the McCanns' apartment.
The reason why this is significant is both sightings were given independently. So when this family gave their statement, they weren't aware of Jane's description. And there's actually quite a lot of similarities. And it does beg the question, I mean, how many people carry the children on a cold night, not covered, you know, nothing on their arms or the feet, no blanket? Now, either there's been two people carrying children in that way who haven't come forward to eliminate themselves, or potentially they're related.
But you think that child is Madeleine?
I think there's a good chance it could be Madeleine. Certainly the description there sounds to me like Madeleine.
Kate and the Find Madeleine campaign coordinator travel to the search team's offices. They want to discuss the details of the upcoming reconstructions and three potentially key witness statements that all tell of a man hanging around the McCanns' apartment in the days leading up to May the 3rd, 2007.
Apart from the obvious of Jane, is sighting number three, the man in the alouette at the back of the apartment. Is definitely a very important sighting because it links them.
The investigators have examined the statements from the three different witnesses and are now convinced that prior to Madeleine's abduction, the McCanns were being watched. The team hope this new information will give them the breakthrough they need.
You'd think it's got to be the same person, wouldn't you, really? Yeah.
And all three say that he was watching the apartment.
Yeah. We're here to discuss the pending reconstruction that we want done.
So, basically, it looks like we've got five sightings, really. Two, a man with a child, and three, just a suspicious individual.
Yeah.
At the beginning of this discussion, Kate McCann introduces a very important idea. She says both sightings were given independently. But what did Gonçalo Amaral say in his book? The Smiths learn that, according to Jane Tanner's statements, Murat is definitely the man encountered on the night of the abduction. Mr. Smith then gets in touch with the Irish police to relate what he saw on the night of May the 3rd. Were they working from the same script? Let's now look at the second time Smithman comes up in this documentary.
It is possible that Jane Tanner is not the only person who saw Madeleine being carried away by the abductor. Forty minutes after Jane's sighting, and half a mile away from the McCanns' apartment, a family also saw a man carrying a young girl away from the town. Later, the witness thought that this might have been Jerry McCann, but this was investigated and ruled out by the Portuguese police.
A man was seen here carrying a child just before 10 p.m. on the night Madeleine was abducted. When the man saw the family, he appeared furtive and veered off to one side and carried on walking. But obviously, anyone carrying a child at night, it's really important. We need to find out who this person was.
I was with my family. We'd been out for the night and we were walking up this street when I saw a man and he was carrying a child. I thought they were father and daughter, so I wasn't so suspicious. The girl was about 4. She looked like my granddaughter, blonde hair, pale white skin, typically British. The man didn't look like a tourist. I can't explain why. It was probably from his clothes.
Someone knows the information, and someone knows who took Madeleine, and someone knows where she is. Let's get moving. Let's get the phone ringing.
The first thing to note about this statement is Dave Edgar's spin on what the Smith family say about their sightings. He says the man appeared furtive and veered off to one side. To our knowledge, the Smiths in their statements do not say he appeared furtive, nor veered off to one side. He appears to have misled the viewers. Secondly, the family witness statement that is read out by the narrator is not a direct reading from Martin Smith's statement. It is selective and edited. Third, despite Martin Smith's statement back in September 2007 to claim that Jerry McCann was probably the man he'd seen on that dark night in May, this is now curtly dismissed by the narrator, who says, "The witness thought that this might have been Jerry McCann, but this was investigated and ruled out by the Portuguese police." The effigies said to have been created by the Smiths during 2008 were not shown in this documentary. Why not? If the McCann team believed that these effigies were drawn up by the Smiths, as they had apparently been told by ex-MI5 investigator Henry Exton, why were they not shown to all the viewers back in May 2009?